At the moment, we have the beautiful Rosalind inside the building. And I'm going to call her Rosie because I love that name.
Oh, hello. Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and what do you do?
I'm an artist and I live in Broccoli, and I've been painting basically since I left the Royal College of Art 7 years ago, and I've been making a lot of series of works about buildings and architecture and lots of kind of the issues around things like social housing and the riots.
But recently, like, you brought some of your stuff in today, and I actually wanted to sneak one into my bag and take it home, but unfortunately she said no. But can you describe to us how you brought about that you decided to do a series of collections of artists with the riots?
Yeah. Well, obviously, we were all massively affected by them in London.
Of course, yeah.
And sort of experiencing that very kind of vulnerable, very difficult time, I've always been interested in sort of why things happen, like, for example, you know, with social housing, where it went wrong and why it goes wrong, like the Haygate estate,
yeah,
and all those kind of political aspects behind it, you know, in the government and things
like
that.
The Haygate estate and elephant,
yeah.
So I've
done paintings of that to sort of also think about the human experience of living in those spaces and living through the riots and why they happened. And it's just that thing that with, you know, with anything that I do with painting and lots of other artists, it's doing something and exploring something that we're curious about. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, why did things happen? And you know,
was you personally affected? And if you was, did that influence your actual drawings?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the actual paintings, they're of glass and they're of they're almost indistinguishable in some ways for being, you know, a specific building. They're kind of panes of glass that broken. But yeah, I was affected. I mean. I was cycling through Peckham when the Peckham riots broke out.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And that was really scary because you feel so suddenly vulnerable, like on a bike.
Of course,
like,
yeah.
Just tear you down, you know. You could feel all of these people just watching and this kind of, this fear in the air or this tension, and you thought, oh my God, it's going to go ballistic. I've never cycled so fast in my life out of it.
Good workout.
Yeah. It was like spin glass. But and then outside my house, there were massive gangs congregating and coming, and they'd all covered their faces on motorbikes and stuff. And basically I was stuck in my house for a couple of days because I didn't want to leave the house because there were just massive gangs. So, you know, that kind of violence as well is really difficult. Like, if, I don't know, growing up in South London, most people probably been attacked at one time or another, and I was, and you kind of felt, you suddenly really, really remembered that experience of being attacked, and it was something had happened to me sort of at the time of the riot. So I was trying to kind of rebuild myself.
Okay.
And then all this violence broke out around me. So there's always like this personal element, you know. I grew up in social housing and that's why I was interested in it. But yeah, all these things growing up around me sort of really made those shockwaves. So the paintings are about trying to repair all of those kind of horrible things.
Do you feel that you have done that with your paintings?
I think so. I think that with, as soon as you paint something, you make it valuable. And what I've done with this kind of broken glass is to really bring it kind of grace and beauty. You know, I stitch into the surface and it's very delicate and meticulous, and there's a real sense of sort of I guess a sense of something else going on beyond what you can see.
No, I agree. I feel the same way when I'm looking at it now. I can totally see where you're coming from with like the riots, the glass. I can see that imagery, but there's sort of a delicacy to it with the texture that you've decided to use.
How did you come with the colour?
Well, it's just all the colours that were actually there, you know, the kind of, as soon as you shatter glass, you get all those different reflections of green and white and everything like that. And then there was kind of this, there's this kind of, it's almost like a grotto. You see through the broken glass and there's these little glimpses of, you know, a counter or something that's left behind.
Yeah.
I love the imagery. For you guys who wants to get in touch and get your questions off to Rosalind, please do not hesitate. Tweet us at Reprezent Radio, and that's with a Z, or call us at 0276398420. That's 0276398420. But for now, we're going to go with Nicki Minaj and Starships.
Starships.
My my name's Rakisha, and I like Feel Good Friday because school's finished and I have the weekend to relax.
My name is Raquel. I like really Feel Good Friday because it's weekend and you get to party.
Basically, it's the last day of work and the next day I can sleep the whole day.
My name is Jamila. I feel good on a Friday because you get to party, innit? And have fun and relax, you know, look forward to the wonderful weekend. Maybe awful weekend sometimes, but yeah. Friday's great.
My name is Mark, yeah. I feel good on a Friday because before Friday night, like during the day, I go chill with my friends, yeah? And then in the night, I go to church. Night vigil, innit? And then I come to church, come back from church, yeah? Friday, no. yeah, that's it.
Let's go to the beach, each, let's go get a wave. They say what they gonna say. Have a drink, clink, found a Bud Light. Bad bitch like me, it's hard to come by. The Patron, oh, let's go get it down. The sound, oh, yes, I'm in the zone. Is it 2, 3? Leave a good tip. I'ma blow all of my money and don't give
I'm
two.
On the floor.
That was Nicki Minaj's Starships from a recent album that she put out.
And you were locked into 107.3 with Sandy, JJ and our very special, beautiful guest, Rosalind, in the building with us. And we've got, thanks for the questions. If you want to keep in touch as well, for those who haven't managed to get through to me, call us at 087-639-8420. That's included the person who just called and I accidentally dropped the phone. I'm so, so sorry. And tweet us at Reprezent Radio and that's over Z. We've got a question from Stacey from South London who says she wants to get into art. What would be your personal... personal opinion in terms of getting her to be more motivated into following her career path?
I think you need to be really passionate about it. It's a really hard business. Mm-hmm. And it's a business like anything else as fulfilling as and vocational as it is. So I think being passionate, being really involved in looking at the art around yeah. you and seeing how other people do it, I think you always learn by example. Like just going around and actually just looking physically at a lot of how people paint or draw or whatever it is, yeah. sculpt. So being really, really involved. Peers, like trying to kind of get to talk to other artists and join like classes or clubs or go to talks, things like that. I mean, it depends like how old and all that stuff. But I think that's the thing is getting involved with it and not sort of and committing to it as a project, you know, sort of thinking I'm going to do a series of work about this and then do it and fulfill it and, you know, believe in it.
So how do you sell your art if you like wanted to sell, like get money for it or like yeah. get credit for it or different things like that?
Yeah,
want
well,
it to be seen?
Yeah, I mean, well, I have exhibitions and sell work at exhibitions, but I also sort of sell directly to people that really love my work that have started following me through my website, rosalindavis.co.uk. And yeah, basically, you know, the funny thing is people really love the subject matter. They really sort of really engage with it. And so when I talk about it, they sort of fall in love with it a little bit. So that tends to happen, and other people try and sell my work too. It's a bit of a funny one. But you know, the funny thing is, it's like we have open studios this weekend, and I met my old school teacher from Sydenham. I went to Sydenham Girls, and and she got in touch with me via my website, and she's at the same Rosalind, and I was like, yeah. She came and she's bought some work because she loves it. She's, you know, sort of got that connection with me now. So
how does that make you feel when I know it's your work, but yeah. it's actually going to be taken out and somebody else is going to go home with it? How does that make you feel?
Well, somebody bought some work the other day and I was like, you know, look after my baby, okay?
And then mine.
Yeah. You know, you can have them for a while, but, you know, it still belongs to me. But, you know, it's so amazing when people do want to buy your work. You know, I mean, it's not why I make my work, but it is. I do want to try and make a living from it.
Of course, yeah.
But, you know, I mean, it is really special.
Rosie,
really.
How do you know the right price?
The right price.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I want to know. How do you know the right price?
Think of a number and double it. No, I'm joking. I'm joking.
I love this girl.
No, I mean, you have to look at the market, like with anything, like, you know, fashion. Yeah. You know, whereabouts are you placed? Are you young? Are you experienced? You know.
Oh, okay.
So you kind of, and you sort of kind of incrementally go, like you go up a little bit after sort of certain points in your career. So a lot of people try and sort of help with that whole aspect of pricing your work.
I want to know, did you always want to be an artist? Is it something that you kind of stumbled across, or is it fate that brought you to it?
I was trying really hard not to be an artist.
Why?
Because my dad was an artist.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And I thought, you know, I'm
going the opposite way.
Yeah. I'm going to go and study English and drama. And but, you know, the lure of it was that I kind of actually went into art through textiles. I did textiles.
Yeah.
So I was kind of like, okay, you know, you can have a career in textiles. You could do print, you can do this, that, and the other. And got convinced by Chelsea College of Art, where I went, to kind of think about it as a career. And I thought, okay, hang on a minute. I can be sort of, maybe I can have a kind of career, but still be creative in that way. And so I went to Chelsea and actually did textile design there. And then I went on from there to Royal College of Art. And became more and more painting, like it just kind of crept back in, and it was what satisfied me. And you know, you kind of have to be true to yourself.
So what was the turning point that you thought, you know what, I'm going to do art and there's no going back?
When I cancelled I was meant to be going to do a degree in East Anglia, and I phoned them up and I said I'm not coming.
Seriously?
I got into Chelsea and I was like, I'm not going to go. I mean, also, you know, there were, yeah, it was, I don't know, just a belief that I had to kind of fulfill that passion. You know,
you've never looked back since.
Yeah.
I'm glad you haven't looked back since, because they're fantastic. They're absolutely amazing. And one of the questions that I want to ask is this one in particular that is right in front of me.
Yeah.
What was going through your mind? What words can you describe that you thought, you know, that influenced you to create this?
When I'm making them, I'm sort of really absorbed in the process. Mm. And, you know, I'm thinking, how do I paint glass? And really, I'm just kind of really, like, I paint with oils, and it's a really wonderful thing to paint with, because it's, it just kind of is so kind of flexible and has so much expression. And you sort of just, you're just thinking about that paintbrush on the canvas. Mm-hmm. You know, you're kind of not necessarily thinking of words, but you're feeling things.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, I guess. Lots of different things. You know?
I think I'm going to change my career. JJ, are you with me on this one?
I don't know.
You're out of
here. It's too difficult for me.
Up next, 110%. You guys get your calls and your messages coming in. Tweet us at Reprezent Radio. Call us at 0076398420. That's 0076398420. But for now, it's Jessie Ware.
Jessie Ware.
Hi, this is Jessie Ware, and you're listening to Reprezent Radio. Reprezent.
That was Jessie Ware, 110%. And next up, we got what these hood rats requested, Martha and Nancy, She Ain't You by Chris Brown.
Thank you. quite some nights now. It's not the same in my bed. But if she found out what's going on in my head, it'll be all bad, have me right back. But you don't understand me, girl. When she touches me, I'm wishing that they were your hands. And when I'm with her, it's only by the sex. But you, I had a bad romance.
That was Chris Brown, She Ain't You.
I'm not quite sure what's wrong with JJ today, but you are locked into 107.3, Sandy and JJ and the beautiful Rosalind in the building, taking you through your lunchtime. We have so many questions that people's been flinging in and throwing us at us. But at the moment, we've got Rebecca from South London. Thank you for getting in touch with us. She said, what do you think your reasons for the actions and the reactions of the riots last year?
I think it's really complicated. I think a lot of people were very unhappy, obviously, because they felt that, to be honest, everything around them was corrupt. You know, obviously it started with the shooting, and people felt the police were corrupt, people feel the government's corrupt, people felt politicians were corrupt, and journalism is corrupt.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it was, there's suddenly that, I think it was that kind of mounting thing of, you know, where is the kind of example of what goodness shall be?
Absolutely,
like, let's break it down. And it doesn't feel like there's a lot of kind of great examples in those kind of current territories in some respects. Obviously, there's some great people doing great things, but I think it was, you know, ultimately unhappiness. Obviously, you know, people feeling they can't get out of a situation of poverty. I mean, you know, but then you have the kind of people that were just seized with a kind of crowd
excitement,
mentality,
yeah,
and just getting involved for reasons of, I don't know, probably just, again, that unhappiness and breaking out of it, really. And then the reactions, well, there's no real, you know, there isn't a kind of tidy bow you can put around it and say, yeah, it was just this or just that. You know, we can't kind of explain it away, and I guess that's what I'm curious about, and, you know, what are the reasons? I don't know if you guys have any ideas or opinions.
They're looking at you, JJ. No, I totally agree with you. I think there's a selection of reasons, and I think what the first reaction for everybody else to do was just to point fingers. Oh yes, it's the government. Oh yes, it's the parents. Oh yes, it's the young people. Which I think every individual on which was pointed out, I think everybody had a role to play. And I don't think maybe all of us played it at our best ability, but I think looking back this time, I think there's been a vast improvement because the young people have definitely been focused this year, especially with the Olympics.
Yeah.
There's many young people that they're, you know, inspiring higher, and there's just loads of positivity. Well, that's what I personally feel anyway. So I don't know. I think there's an improvement. I think the reaction was really bad last year. Everybody was just pointing fingers. That's my own personal opinion. But I think there's a vast improvement, and I'm quite happy with that.
What do you
think
started the riots?
I'm going to say parents.
Parents?
Yeah. Oh, my days.
I say that because I think that there was, obviously, there was loads of young people involved. And I think there's, no, like, I stick to my guns. There's loads of reasons. But I think one of the main one is parents. If you bring a child to this earth, it's your duty and your responsibility to bring up that child in the best way that you can. Yeah. No matter the religion, no matter where you come from, everybody knows right from wrong. And stealing is wrong, yeah, by all means.
No,
and
yeah.
It's just, you, as a parent,
I don't think you could blame it on
No,
parents.
You definitely have to.
You can't.
I mean, there's definitely an element of parental responsibility, but
massively.
You have to think at the same time that those parents may be going through some really challenging economic stuff.
But then maybe
you could be the best parent in the world, no, you but can't. You don't know what your child is doing out behind closed doors.
There's a reason why people like me and you didn't. Oh, well, I hope you didn't.
I didn't.
There's a reason why me and you didn't go around just stealing at that point in time. Do you know what I mean? And it's not that my parents was with me. I could have easily just, you know, got carried away. Mm. But there's, you know, there's the principle and it stays with you. It should be embedded in you. And I don't know. I think parents should, you know, come on.
Embed it.
Yeah,
but
should.
You know, if you don't have those kind of role models, like, find them, you know, I think... I've always tried to do that, and it's like you have to, you know, it's that phrase, be the change you want to see in the world.
I think
regardless of if you've got good or bad parents, you have to take that on yourself.
It's true
because there was even, I remember, was it, I don't know if it was the Olympics, there was a girl that was going to train for the Olympics and she was part of the riots.
Oh yeah.
And they looked up to her, like, in the community as in one of the idols,
respectable
people, and she was in the riots.
Did she say why?
Yeah, I really would love to hear her excuse.
I think she's in jail now.
See, oh, you know, throwing everything away for nothing.
But that's the thing, if you don't know the importance of what you have, it's easy to throw it away.
Yeah.
For real.
It's to be honest, like, if this is me being here is a fantastic opportunity, but if I don't know the value of it, I would just say, no, I'd rather go party with my friends right now, which is what they're actually doing.
Yeah.
And I hope you're actually listening, because I chose not to, and be a good girl and stay here.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, I totally agree with you. But coming back to the paintings. I've got a personal question. I want to know, what was going through your mind when you was actually creating all of it, the whole series? What was actually going through your mind? Despite the riots, was there any personal aims that you wanted to get out of this, apart from, you know, showcasing your work?
That's a tough one. I think I felt quite a lot of sadness, really. Yeah. You know, personal sadness and, you know, the kind of about the situation and kind of the long-term situations that kind of that governments can make that have such an impact, I think. I was thinking, you know, you're absorbed, it's really absorbing, so you're kind of accumulating all these thoughts and feelings and also kind of joy.
Mm.
You know, to me, to be able to paint and do this is like a complete joy. So in a way, all of that kind of joy and sadness, I feel, is really present in the work. It's really, it's about commemoration, you know.
Yeah, of course.
So it's almost like I'm doing this and stitching and repairing things. I'm trying to repair it, you know, as best as I can in my very sort of, not very passionate at all, but in the way, only way that we all can is like trying to repair ourselves, try and repair the situation around us.
I feel like you've played your part. Now it's time for me to do mine. JJ, I'm looking at you because it's time to step up. Yeah. And we have a question from Joshua, who says, if you were to describe your work in three words, what would it be and why?
Oh, well, I have got that one nailed. Transformation, process, and material.
Wow.
So it's all about transforming spaces. And obviously material is really important. And the process of, you know, because I get very involved. I read a lot. I go and photograph places. I look at lots of newspapers, blogs, everything. Talk to people about it. So it's very involved. But also, I run Zeitgeist Arts Projects, which is again about transforming, and for the young artist that was wanting to kind of get out there, we run a DIY Educate program, which is for artists, by artists, for artists.
That's
by me
fantastic.
And my partner, Annabelle Tilly, my business partner, and we do lots of talks to tell people about really what the art world is really like, how challenging it can be, you know, the ups and downs. Like, we had somebody that was nominated for the Turner Prize, and you know, he lives in Broccoli, Mark Titchener, and he was brilliant because he was kind of like, his whole world went up and it also went really down at times, you know, and you kind of need to hear that reassuring journey.
Yeah.
And it's brilliant because other artists are kind of meeting other artists through us all the time. And then we've got open studios tonight to actually come and meet us, and tomorrow, and I'll be around also next weekend if anyone wants to come and see the paintings.
Can you tell us where it is and how how we can get involved.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we open tonight at 6 and we're at ASC Studios. We've got a Zap Doorbell, which is Zeitgeist Arts Projects, and that's Bond House, Goodwood Road, SC14 6BL. It's really near to New Crossgate Station.
Okay.
Right on the road where Iceland is, if you know that. And
okay,
near
Goldsmiths. Yeah.
Yeah, and just come and ring on the Zap Bell. There it is doors, but you know, you're really welcome. So, and I'd love to talk to people about the work.
The Zap Bell.
Zap bell.
Just has a zap to it.
Yeah.
We also have another question. Okay, Troy wants to know how we can get in touch with you and your work.
Oh, well, it's you can get in touch with me on Twitter. It's Rosalind Davis, so that's Rosalind Davis. I think Reprezent, you tweeted me, right? So, yeah. You know, follow Reprezent.
Yeah.
At the moment, we have the beautiful Rosalind inside the building, and I'm going to call her Rosie because I love that name.
Oh, hello. Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and what do you do?
I'm an artist and I live in Broccoli, and I've been painting basically since I left the Royal College of Art 7 years ago, and I've been making a lot of series of works about buildings and architecture and lots of kind of the issues around things like social housing and the riots.
But recently, like, you brought some of your stuff in today, and I actually wanted to sneak one into my bag and take it home, but unfortunately she said no. But can you describe to us how you brought about that you decided to do a series of collections of artists with the riots?
Yeah. Well, obviously, we were all massively affected by them in London.
Of course, yeah.
And sort of experiencing that very kind of vulnerable, very difficult time. I've always been interested in sort of why things happen, like, for example, you know, with social housing, where it went wrong and why it goes wrong, like the Haygate Estate.
Yeah.
And all those kind of political aspects behind it, you know, in the government and things
like
that.
The Haygate Estate and Elephant?
Yeah.
So I've
done paintings of that. To sort of also think about the human experience of living in those spaces and living through the riots and why they happened. And it's just that thing that with anything that I do with painting and lots of other artists, it's doing something and exploring something that we're curious about. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, why did things happen? And you know,
was you personally affected? And if you was, did that influence your actual drawings?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the actual paintings, they're of glass and they're they're almost indistinguishable in some ways for being, you know, a specific building. They're kind of panes of glass that are broken. But yeah, I was affected. I was cycling through Peckham when the Peckham riots broke out.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And that was really scary because you feel so suddenly vulnerable, like on a bike.
Of course,
like,
yeah.
Just tear you down. You know, you could feel all of these people just watching, and this kind of this fear in the air, or this tension, and you thought, oh my god, it's going to go ballistic. I've never cycled so fast in my life. Out.
Good workout.
Yeah, it was like spin glass. But yeah, and then outside my house, there were massive gangs congregating and coming, and they'd all covered their faces on motorbikes and stuff. And basically, I was stuck in my house for a couple of days because I didn't want to leave the house because there were just massive gangs. So, you know, that kind of violence as well is really difficult. Like, if, I don't know, growing up in South London, most people probably been attacked at one time or another, and I was, and you kind of felt, you suddenly really, really remembered that experience of being attacked. And it was something had happened to me sort of at the time of the riot. So I was trying to kind of rebuild myself.
Okay.
And then all this violence broke out around me. So there's always like this personal element, you know. I grew up in social housing and that's why I was interested in it. But yeah, all these things growing up around me sort of really made those shockwaves. So the paintings are about trying to repair all of those kind of horrible things.
Do you feel that you have done that with your paintings?
I think so. I think that as soon as you paint something, you make it valuable, and what I've done with this kind of broken glass is to really bring it kind of grace and beauty. You know, I stitch into the surface and it's very delicate and meticulous, and there's a real sense of sort of I guess a sense of something else going on beyond what you can see.
No, I agree. I feel the same way when I'm looking at it now. I can totally see where you're coming from with like the riots, the glass. Mm. I can see that imagery, but there's sort of a delicate to it with the texture that you've decided to use.
How did you come with the colour?
Well, it's just all the colours that were actually there. You know, the kind of, as soon as you shatter glass, you get all those different reflections of green and white and everything like that. And then there was kind of this, there's this kind of, it's almost like a grotto. You see through the broken glass and there's these little glimpses of, you know, a counter or something that's left behind.
Yeah.
I love the imagery. For you guys who wants to get in touch and get your questions off to Rosalind, please do not hesitate. Tweet us at Reprezent Radio, and that's with a Z, or call us at 0207-639-8420. That's 0207-639-8420. But for now, we're going to go with Nicki Minaj and Starships.
Starships.
My name's Rakisha, and I like Feel Good Friday because school's finished and I have the weekend to relax.
My name is Echo. I like really Feel Good Friday because it's weekend and you get to party.
Basically, it's the last day of work and the next day I can sleep the whole day.
My name is Jamila. I feel good on a Friday because you get to party, innit, and have fun and relax, you know, look forward to the wonderful weekend. Maybe awful weekend sometimes, but yeah. Friday's great.
My name is Mark, yeah. I feel good on a Friday because Friday night, no, before Friday night, like during the day, I go chill with my friends, yeah? And then in the night, I go to church, night vigil, innit? And then I come to church, come back from church, yeah? Friday, no. yeah, that's it.
Let's go to the beach, each, let's go get a wave. They say what they gonna say. Have a drink, clink, found a Bud Light. Bad bitch like me, it's hard to come by. The Patron, oh, let's go get it now. The sound, oh, yes, I'm in the zone. Is it 2, 3, leave a good tip. I'ma blow all of my money and don't give
I'm on the floor.
One more time.
That was Nicki Minaj, Starships, from a recent album that she put out.
And you were locked into 107.3 with Sandy, JJ, and our very special, beautiful guest, Rosalind, in the building
Rosalind.
With us. And we've got, thanks for the questions. That we'll, if you want to keep in touch as well, for those who haven't managed to get through to me, call us at 807-639-8420. That's included the person who just called and I accidentally dropped the phone. I'm so, so sorry. And tweet us at Reprezent Radio, and that's over Z. We've got a question from Stacey from South London, who says she wants to get into art. What would be your personal opinion in terms of getting her to be more motivated into following her career path?
I think you need to be really passionate about it. It's a really hard business. Mm-hmm. And it's a business like anything else, as fulfilling as and vocational as it is. So I think being passionate, being really involved in looking at the art around yeah. you and seeing how other people do it, I think you always learn by example. Like just going around and actually just looking physically a lot of how people paint or draw or whatever it yeah. is, sculpt. So being really, really involved. Peers, like trying to kind of get to talk to other artists and join like classes or clubs or go to talks, things like that. I mean, it depends like how old and all that stuff. But I think that's the thing, is getting involved with it and not sort of, and committing to it as a project, you know, sort of thinking I'm going to do a series of work about this and then do it and fulfill it and, you know, believe in it.
So how do you sell your art if you like wanted to sell, like get money for it or like yeah. get credit for it or different things like that?
Yeah,
want
well,
it to be seen?
Yeah, I mean, well, I have exhibitions and sell work at exhibitions, but I also sort of sell directly to people that really love my work, that have started following me through my website, rosalindavis.co.uk. And yeah, basically, you know, the funny thing is people really love the subject matter. They really sort of really engage with it, and so when I talk about it, they sort of fall in love with it a little bit. So that tends to happen, and other people try and sell my work too. It's a, again, it's a bit of a funny one, but you know, the funny thing is it's like we have open studios this weekend, and I met my old school teacher from Sydenham. I went to Sydenham Girls, and yeah, and she got in touch with me via my website, and she's at the same Rosalind, and I was like, yeah, she came and she's bought some work because she loves it. She's, you know, sort of got that connection with me now. So
how does that make you feel when I know it's your work, but yeah. it's actually going to be taken out and somebody else is going to go home with it? How does that make you feel?
Well, somebody bought some work the other day and I was like, you know, look after my baby, okay? And they're mine. But, yeah, you know, you can have them for a while, but, you know, it still belongs to me. But, you know, it's so amazing when people do want to buy your yeah. work. You know, I mean, it's not why I make my work, but it is. I do want to try and make a living from
it. Of course, yeah.
But, you know, I mean, it is really special.
Rosalind,
really.
How do you know the right price?
The right price.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I want to know. How do you know the right price?
Think of a number and double it. No, I'm joking. I'm joking.
I love this.
No, I mean, you basically, you have to look at the market, like with anything, like, you know, fashion, yeah. you know, yeah, whereabouts yeah, yeah. are you placed, are you young, are you experienced, you know.
Oh, okay.
So you kind of, yeah, and you sort of kind of incrementally go, like you go up a little bit after sort of certain points in your career. So a lot of people try and sort of help with that whole aspect of pricing your work.
I want to know, did you always want to be an artist? Is it something that you kind of stumble across, or is it fate that brought you to it?
I was trying really hard not to be an artist.
Why?
Because my dad was an artist.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And I thought, you know, I don't.
I'm going the opposite way.
Yeah. I'm going to go and study English and drama, and but you know, the lure of it was that I kind of actually went into art through textiles. I did textiles.
Yeah.
So I was kind of like, okay, you know, you can have a career in textiles. You could do print, you can do this, that, and the other. And got convinced by Chelsea College of Art, where I went, to kind of think about it as a career. And I thought, okay, hang on a minute. I can be sort of, maybe I can have a kind yeah. of career, but still be creative in that way. And so I went to Chelsea and actually did textile design there. And then I went on from there to Royal College of Art. And became more and more painting, like it just kind of crept back in, and it was what satisfied me. And you know, you kind of have to be true to yourself.
So what was the turning point that you thought, you know what, I'm going to do art and there's no going back?
When I cancelled my, I was meant to be going to do a degree in East Anglia, and okay. I phoned them up and I said, I'm not coming.
Seriously?
I got into Chelsea and I was like, I'm not going to go. I mean, also, you know, there were, yeah, it was, I don't know, just a belief that I had to kind of fulfill that passion. You know,
you've never looked back since. I'm glad you haven't looked back since, because they're fantastic. They're absolutely amazing. And one of the questions that I want to ask is this one in particular that is right in front of me.
Yeah.
What was going through your mind? What words can you describe that you thought, you know, that influenced you to create this?
When I'm making them, I'm sort of really absorbed in the process. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm thinking, how do I paint glass? And really, I'm just kind of really, like, I paint with oils, and it's a really wonderful thing to paint with, because it's, it just kind of is so kind of flexible and has so much expression. And you sort of just, you're just thinking about that paintbrush on the canvas. Mm-hmm. You know, you're kind of not necessarily thinking of words, but you're feeling things.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, I guess lots of different things. You know?
I think I'm going to change my career. JJ, are you with me on this one?
I don't know.
You're out of
here. Too difficult for me.
Up next, 110%. You guys get your calls and your messages coming in. Tweet us at Reprezent Radio. Call us at 0076398420. That's 0076398420. But for now, it's Jessie Ware.
Jessie Ware.
Best in UK music. Hi, this is Jessie Ware, and you're listening to Reprezent Radio. Reprezent.
That was Jessie Ware, 110%. And next up, we got what these hood rats requested, Martha and Nancy, She Ain't You by Chris Brown.
Somebody else, I'm calling her cause I'm thinking about you. You're sure for babe. I never wanted us to break up. No, not this way. But you don't understand it, girl. When she touches me, I'm wishing that they were your hands. And when I'm with her, it's only by the sex. With you, I had a bad romance. And if I could, just trade her in, I would. Cause nobody could pass you up, no. Some nights now, it's not the same in my bed. But if she found out what's going on in my head, it'll be all back, have me right back. But you don't understand me, girl. When she touches me, I'm wishing that they were your hands. And when I'm with her, it's only by the sex. But you, I had a bad romance.
That was Chris Brown, She Ain't You.
I'm not quite sure what's wrong with JJ today, but you are locked into 107.3, Sandy and JJ and the beautiful Rosalind in the building, taking you through your lunchtime. We have so many questions that people's been flinging in and throwing us at us. But at the moment, we've got Rebecca from South London. Thank you for getting in touch with us. She said, what do you think your reasons for the actions and the reactions of the riots last year?
I think it's really complicated. I think a lot of people were very unhappy, obviously, because they felt that, to be honest, everything around them was corrupt. You know, obviously it started with the shooting and people felt the police were corrupt. People feel the government's corrupt. People felt politicians were corrupt and journalism is corrupt.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it was there's suddenly that I think it was that kind of mounting thing of, you know, where is the kind of example of what goodness shall be?
Absolutely,
like, let's break
yeah.
it down. And it doesn't feel like there's a lot of kind of great examples in those kind of current territories in
yeah.
some respects. Obviously, there's some great people doing great things, but I think it was, you know, ultimately unhappiness. Obviously, you know, people feeling they can't get out of a situation of poverty. I mean, you know, but then you have the kind of people that were just seized with kind of crowd excitement, mentality and just getting involved for reasons of, I don't know, probably just, again, that unhappiness and breaking out of it, really. And then the reactions, well, there's no real, you know, there isn't a kind of tidy bow you can put around it and say, yeah, it was just this or just that. You know, we can't kind of explain it away. And I guess that's what I'm curious about. And, you know, what are the reasons? I don't know if you guys have any ideas or opinions.
You're looking at you, JJ. No, I totally agree with you. I think there's a selections of reasons, and I think what the first reaction for everybody else to do was just to point fingers. Oh yes, it's the government. Oh yes, it's the parents. Oh yes, it's the young people. Which I think every individual one which was pointed out, I think everybody had a role to play. And I don't think maybe all of us played it at our best ability, but I think looking back this time, I think there's been a vast improvement because the young people have definitely been focused this year, especially with the Olympics.
Yeah.
There's many young people that they're, you know, inspiring higher, and there's just loads of positivity. Well, that's what I personally feel anyway. So I don't know. I think there's an improvement. I think the reaction was really bad last year. Everybody was just pointing fingers. That's my own personal opinion. But I think there's a vast improvement, and I'm quite happy with that.
What do you think started the riots, Sandy?
I'm going to say parents.
Parents?
Yeah.
Oh, my day.
I say that because I think that there was... Obviously, there was loads of young people involved. And I think... I think there's... No, like, I stick to my guns. There's loads of reasons. But I think one of the main one is parents. If you bring a child to this earth, it's your duty and your responsibility to bring up that child in the best way that you can. No matter the religion, no matter where you come from, everybody knows right from wrong. And stealing is wrong by all means.
No,
and
it's
just, you as a parent...
I don't think you can blame it on
No,
parents.
You definitely have to.
You can't.
I mean, there's definitely an element of parental responsibility, but
massively.
You have to think at the same time that those parents may be going through some really challenging economic stuff.
But then maybe
you could be the best parent in the world, you don't know what your child is doing out behind closed doors.
There's a reason why people like me and you didn't... Oh, well, I hope you didn't.
I didn't.
There's a reason why me and you didn't go around just stealing at that point in time. Do you know what I mean? And it's not that my parents was with me. I could have easily just, you know, got carried away. Mm. But there's, you know, there's the principle, and it stays with you. It should be embedded in you. And I don't know. I think parents should, you know, come on.
Embed it.
Yeah,
but
should.
You know, if you don't have those kind of role models, like, find them. You know, I think... I've always tried to do that, and it's like, you have to, you know, it's that phrase, be the change you want to see in the world.
I think
regardless of if you've got good or bad parents, you have to take that on yourself.
It's true
because there was even, I remember, was it, I don't know if it was the Olympics, there was a girl that was going to train for the Olympics, and she was part of the riots.
Oh yeah.
And they looked up to her, like, in the community, as in one of the idols,
respectable
people, and she was in the riots.
Did she say why?
Yeah, I really would love to hear her excuse.
I think she's in jail now.
See, you know, throwing everything away for nothing.
But that's the thing, if you don't know the importance of what you have, it's easy to throw it away.
Yeah.
For real.
It's to be honest, like, if this is me being here is a fantastic opportunity, but if I don't know the value of it, I would just say, no, I'd rather go party with my friends right now, which is what they're actually doing.
Yeah.
And I hope you're actually listening, because I chose not to, and be a good girl and stay here.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, I totally agree with you. But coming back to the paintings. I've got a personal question. I want to know, what was going through your mind when you was actually creating all of it, the whole series? What was actually going through your mind? Despite the riots, was there any personal aims that you wanted to get out of this, apart from, you know, showcasing your work?
That's a tough one. I think I felt quite a lot of sadness, really.
Yeah.
You know, personal sadness and, you know, the kind of about the situation and kind of long-term situations that kind of that governments can make that have such an impact, I think. I was thinking, you know, you're absorbed, it's really absorbing, so you're kind of accumulating all these thoughts and feelings and also kind of joy.
Mm.
You know, to me, to be able to paint and do this is like a complete joy. So... in a way, all of that kind of joy and sadness I feel is really present in the work. It's really, it's about commemoration, you know.
Yeah, of course.
So it's almost like I'm doing this and stitching and repairing things. I'm trying to repair it, you know, as best as I can in my very sort of, not very passionate at all, but in the way, only way that we all can is like trying to repair ourselves, try and repair the situation around us.
I feel like you've played your part. Now it's time for me to do mine. JJ, I'm looking at you because it's time to step up. Yeah. And we have a question from Joshua who says, if you were to describe your work in three words, what would it be and why?
Oh, well, I've got that one nailed. Transformation, process, and material.
Wow.
So it's all about transforming spaces. And obviously material is really important. And the process of, you know, because I get very involved. I read a lot. I go and photograph places. I look at lots of newspapers, blogs, everything. Talk to people about it. So it's very involved. Also, I run Zeitgeist Arts Projects, which is, again, about transforming. And for the young artist that was wanting to kind of get out there, we run a DIY Educate program, which is for artists, by artists, for artists,
That's
by me
fantastic.
And my partner, Annabelle Tilly, my business partner. And we do lots of talks to tell people about really what the art world is really like, how challenging it can be, you know, the ups and downs. Like, we had somebody that was nominated for the Turner Prize, and, you know, he lives in Broccoli, Mark Titchener, and he was brilliant because he was kind of like, his whole world went up and it also went really down at times, you know, and you kind of need to hear that reassuring journey.
Yeah.
And it's brilliant because other artists are kind of meeting other artists through us all the time. And then we've got Open Studios tonight to actually come and meet us, and tomorrow, and I'll be around also next weekend if anyone wants to come and see the paintings.
Can you tell us where it is and how we can get involved?
Yeah. Well, we open tonight at 6 and we're at ASC Studios. We've got a Zap doorbell, which is Zeitgeist Arts Projects. And that's Bond House, Goodwood Road, SC14 6BL. It's really near to New Crossgate Station.
Okay.
Right on the road where Iceland is, if you know that. And
okay,
near Goldsmiths.
Yeah.
And just come and ring on the Zap bell. There it is doors, but you know, you're really welcome. So, and I'd love to talk to people about the work.
The Zap bell.
Zap bell.
Has a zap to it.
Yeah. Zap.
We also have another question. Okay, Troy wants to know how we can get in touch with you and your work.
Oh, well, it's you can get in touch with me on Twitter. It's Rosalind Davis, so that's RosalindDavis. I think Reprezent, you tweeted me, right? So, you know, follow Reprezent.
Yeah.